welcome everyone to the Color of Woman Poetry Salon. And I'm really extremely excited, as I always am, to introduce one of my favorite women, Caron McCloud, who around Cosmic Cowgirls, I love to say that she is our Cosmic Cowgirl Poet Laureate. And she is has had many identities throughout her life as a writer. She's a published poet. She's an artist. She's was a dress designer. She has been a businesswoman. She is a creative being of all dimensions. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that Caron is I get to talk to her about is identity, and what does that look like for you? And she talks about how if you to visualize yourself on a hill with underneath a tree, and there's a tombstone, and there's one word that describes you, and what is that? And in her teachings, because she's also just a brilliant teacher and a teacher of the Tree of Life, and I hope you all get the opportunity one day to take a course. And she talks about what is that one thing that calls to you, that is your essence of who you are. And on hers, it says pot. Mm-hmm. And one of the things I love about Caron is that she is such a brilliant performance artist, that she brings her words and the language to life. And so it is just my absolute honor to welcome poet Caron McCloud. Wow. Every once in a while you have a moment in your life where you're exactly where you want to be, doing exactly what you want to be doing with whom you exactly want to be doing it with. And so I really, really treasure this moment. I want to say how impressed I am with all of you, with, as I said yesterday, being in circle with you, just seeing your beauty. Each and every one of you, I was able to look at you and see your beauty. And then last night, being here in this space with your work, I was like, I said to Mary, I said, how am I going to sleep out there with all those people? I love that little corner to sleep in. And I was like, how am I going to deal with all this energy? And it's like to go and look at what you were doing and just go, oh my God, look what's taking place here. Color of Woman, we do a lot of workshops, and I love them all, and each of them has their own thing to offer and their own thing that appeals, but for me, Color of Woman is the one in which I have personally witnessed the miracles of seeing someone painting, and all the dark stuff coming up, and them getting more and more frightened and more upset and like, he's a hater, right? Like, oh, who is that? That's, you know. And then at a certain point, one little stroke, she jumps back from the canvas and goes, I love her. You know, and there's healing, and I get healings every time that we're involved in one of these workshops. And I mean, things come up that are years and years and years old that I thought was all, I got that all. But then it's another layer. And watching my daughter make this presentation, I've known her all her life, and I'm still jaw-droppingly impressed by her. And I worked really hard on this presentation that I'm planning to do, but she'd say something, I'd go, oh no, I have to talk about that. And then she'd say something, oh no, I want to address that, that's so important, and on and on and on. And so we're going to read, I'm going to read you a couple of poems, I'm going to talk to you about poetry. We're not going to do an actual poetry exercise writing during this time, because I want to give you as many tools as I can to take home with you, so that you'll have that handy and can do your own thing with it.
Mm-hmm. You actually do have to, because they have that step 12.
So at the end of Mom's presentation, I will let your paintings write from you.
Okay. So
but you'll do it after the,
okay,
the talk.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's leading towards you doing that, so that's
right.
Okay.
So, I want to start by honoring Sue, who was with me when I gave birth to Shiloh, and is such an important part of this, and you, the ones that did get an opportunity to be with her, know what I'm talking about, and even those that didn't get that opportunity, Shiloh carries that forward. And I'm going to, I want to address the blocks that we have against doing the work. I mean, we have so many reasons for not doing it. And we fight those reasons and we argue with those reasons. I'm this or I'm that or I'm not or I am. And I want you to think about the possibility that you can't be fixed. This is the way it turned out. It's who you are. It's what you get to work with. Are you scared? It doesn't matter if I'm facing a room of 1,000 people or 10. Every time that I get up to do this, I get diarrhea, I get scared, I was like, why do I put myself in this place? And but once I'm here and I look out and I see all the love and the support that is always there for someone who is willing to go ahead and get up there and do it, I have to do it. I saw Isaac Stern interviewed by Johnny Carson, and he was talking about being in a rock climbing accident where his hand was crushed. And Johnny Carson said, what was the first thing that went through your mind? Is like, oh my God, I'll never play the violin again. And Isaac Stern said, yes, and I was so relieved. And Johnny Carson was like, what? You know? And he said, why would you say such a thing? He said, because my stage fright is so intolerable. Because after all these years, after playing the most famous halls in the world, he said, yeah, he says, every time, it never changes. So what if whatever is saying no to you, you're stuck with that. You cannot wait for that to clear up. Let's just say you are stuck with it. And you know what? You're stuck with it anyway, so you might as well be doing something. So that's part of what I want to address. When I became serious about wanting to write poetry, the voice was, you don't have anything significant to say. You don't have anything significant to say. And so I went out and got one of the first word processors ever, and had that set up with its little, everything all set up, and I would just turn it on in the morning while I was washing dishes, and sometimes I'd sweep past it and reach over and tap a couple of things. The voice is still going, you have nothing significant to say. And one morning, as I was sweeping in front of it, I was like, oh my God, I have nothing significant to say. What a relief. I'm free. I can write whatever I want. And I've been writing ever since. It's just like, I just owned it that I have nothing significant to say, and now I can say whatever I want. Except, I would get hung up during my periods of time when I'm depressed, because it's part of being a poet, is we get depressed. Like, I don't know any poets that are, like, innately poets who don't get depressed, because the perspective from which we're viewing the universe is pretty intense. So, I would not write during that time, because I did not want people to know what a jerk I am. How sorry I didn't feel for myself. I just, really, poor me. And then I wouldn't write during that period of time. And then one February, my depression was so intense that I'm depressed. Nobody's going to read it. Anyway, I might as well write something and try and write this out. And I did. And I just talked about just how awful I really, really felt in detail. And by the time I got to the end of the poem, it was like there was nothing to live for, nothing to produce, nothing. And then the last line of the poem showed up on the page and it said, however, there is this poem. And so from then on, it's like I started writing during my depressions. In fact, when they come, I'm like Jacob wrestling with the angel. When the angel said, I'm leaving, I'm done. And Jacob said, no, you don't. He hung on to that angel and he said, you're not leaving until you bless me. And Shiloh spoke about this too, and that's where the limp came from. The angel grabbed him in the thigh, blessed him, and changed his name to one who has power with God, from Jacob to Israel. And so, yeah, so this is February Soul, and I dedicated this book to Sue, and I want to read the dedication, and then I want to read the her favorite poem. I mean, I wrote pages and pages and pages of very eloquent poetry in celebration of Sue, but the one that she chose will tell you. It's a short little poem that kind of tell you the whole story. So this is a dedication to Sue Sellers and her gift of perspective. So many people that I know, when I ask them what they got from Sue, they'll say, perspective. I call it the Susie eyes. Once you've seen a tree with Sue, once you've heard a woodpecker with Sue, you've got the Susie eyes and the Susie ears, because she had a way of observing that gives you new eyes. Sue taught me to value myself as a woman. She taught me to value my creativity. She taught me to trust my own perceptions and then taught me entirely new and unique ways to perceive. She taught me to attend to detail that would never be seen by anyone but God. She taught me how to include within a composition that which has not yet been resolved and to see the unanswered questions as great adventures. She taught me to value the dark things in myself that I wanted to get rid of, like guilt and shame and mistakes and my depressions. She said, don't you throw that out, girl, she'd tell me. All that stuff has cost you a lot and it is very valuable. You just compost that stuff and you'll see something really fine begin to grow out of it. Sue also taught this perspective to my children and did more to help me raise them than anyone else besides my mom. Mm. She's also one of the few people I know who's heavy enough to handle a dedication of material which has bloomed out of some of the darkest compostings. And this is the poem that she always requested when I was doing her reading, and it's called The Separatist. This was in the beginning of the women's movement, when we were really, really active, and when it all started to change, and that we thought that the books that we were reading should be labeled like cigarette packages that said, caution, could be dangerous to your mental health. It was an incredible time in the 70s, late 60s and the 70s. So this is The Separatist. She no longer laughs with us. She perches, vulture-like, along the ledges of our conversations, waiting to devour any ragged piece of dead, male-identified dialogue. Laboring under her vigilant eye, we struggle to give birth to our truths, whole, instant, parthenogenic, lest the stench of our divulgence invite attack. I fight to find my footing amongst those cranky crags,
But I have to admit, I am relieved once she regurgitates our little abortions and goes out to take tea with her goats. And I want to, my son, Jonathan, is always continues to amaze me. I'll quote something from Marshall McLuhan and say, oh, you're too young to know anything about Marshall McLuhan. And he walks over to his bookcase and pulls out the book on probes, right? It's, wow. And then the other night, when we were together, he read this from a telegram from Marcel Duchamp. And it's called Choice. And it's The Artist Chooses. The artist chooses a bowl of apples, or a field of wheat with crows circling, or a nude woman sitting on the edge of a bed looking at a square of light on the floor, or a rich man with his possessions, or Christ, or a can of soup. The artist chooses a thing and says, look at this. And this just really, really spoke to me, because it's about the little things. It's about the insignificant things. It's about the things that people don't notice because they're so taken for granted, or they don't have the eye for it, or the aesthetic to appreciate it. But you take that can of soup, or you take that feeling that you have about Christ, or any little thing that you're feeling, that this bottle of water, whatever, you can transform that for someone so that they can have an experience in it. So it's like, there's all of the symbols that our cultures are full of, all of our cultures are full of. And you're creating your own, calling them up here on these canvases that speak specifically to you. Pay attention to what she's telling you. This is, I was looking at Jonathan's, he shared his photographs with me a few days ago and blew me away. I mean, this is our photographer. This is the man who's making all this possible for us to be able to cross the oceans. And his photography is absolutely brilliant. He's got an impeccable eye, perfect composition. And this morning he brought me a handful of photographs that I was awing over. And this is focusing on the buildings at the corner of Sansom and Montgomery in San Francisco, and their electric bus lines. Sure, I've got it right side up. And when I saw this on his computer, it made me cry. Because, to me, this is like a portrait of myself. This is the kind of suspension that I feel I live in, like these electric bus lines strung across these two separate worlds, light and dark, some reflection, some absorbing, just enough flex in the line to give me some hope and some movement. But I operate at such extremes. And I know that many of you do, because you wouldn't be here if you weren't, because you're artists and you're poets. And that's where we live. We live in this between the worlds that Shiloh is always talking about, where she dances. I just got this morning, and it made me cry again. It's like, this is a picture of some electric bus lines. Hello?
On streets we've walked down our whole life.
So, thank you so much, Sam. So, now I'm going to honor Shiloh's wish that I read to you about Muse Red. And I want to state again, let her show up how she wants to show up. Actually, you probably can't keep her from it. And like Shiloh was saying earlier, there's sometimes she's there and you don't even recognize that that is what's going on, that she is there. So, I'm going to start with her. And one of the things she started with was a quote from Hesiod, who was a Greek poet thought by scholars to be contemporary with Homer, somewhere between 750 and 650 BC. And he said that the poets talked to him, and he actually the violet muses, which are very famous mythological muses from that era. He says, this is what the muses told him, the seven of them. We know how to speak false things, which seem to be true. But we know when we will to utter true things. So you can see she's a bit, they're a bit frisky, you know. They can tell us things that seem to be true, but they can also utter totally true things. So, Muse read. It was 4 a.m. Then this is not a poem, this is just prose. It was 4 a.m., that strange blue-lit hour of the dog, and I had just completed a trilogy of poetry chapbooks, which I had been working on nonstop for 6 weeks. Heaving a great sigh of relief, I was reaching for the shutdown command on my iMac, one of those big old first ones, orange. Just reaching for the shutdown command on my iMac when my fingers suddenly flew to the keyboard and a poem showed up on the screen. A poem of which I did not experience myself as being the source. What? I exclaimed aloud after reading it. Where did this come from? What do you mean, where? I heard in a sexy Stella Mac kind of voice. Why, from me, of course. Who are you? I asked, looking around in shock. Since I hadn't consumed any alcohol or drugs in years, well, except for a few hits off a little holy smoke that occasionally showed up with a little help from a friend or two, I figured my hallucinatory state was due to long nights and obsessive writings. What do you mean, who? The voice said. I'm Muse Red, of course. I don't believe in muses, I said, my body stiffening, my arms folding. I'm a Christian. For some reason, I was more surprised than embarrassed by the uncharacteristically prim sound of my own voice echoing in the room than I was at the fact that I was carrying on a conversation with an aberration. I realized the Stella Mac sounding voice was taking on form, as long, perfectly manicured fingers flashing Revlon's fire and ice nail polish from the 50s reached over my shoulder and picked up the manuscript I had just printed. She read the title aloud. Cantos in the Red. Now where do you think this came from? Who do you think has been propping you up at this computer all day and all night for the last 6 weeks? Then peering at the poem that had showed up on my computer screen, she said, and where do you think this little number came from? I don't even like that poem. Proving my point, she noted, intensifying the tension between us. Just what do you and your exalted opinion think is wrong with it? Well, for one thing, it's a calligramma, a form I never use, a form I find just too, if you'll forgive the pun, contrived for words. What about E.E. Cummings, she queried. Screw E.E. Cummings, I said. Who about a poet I actually like and respect? My awe at her presence overcome by my feelings of being not only invaded, but challenged. Well, it was at this point that she and I got into a terrible quarrel. Even though I know better than to fight with a redhead. Especially one. Wearing a long, flimsy, bias-cut, red sequin, vintage 20s evening gown at 4 freaking o'clock in the morning. recording a bunch of stuff from Ben Sean, like, form is the right and only possible shape of a certain content. I told her that even more than the shape of the poem that had showed up on my page, it was the content that I found offensive. I tried to explain that the poem was just too, well, too occult sounding, and that I had put away all of that sort of thing years ago because of my, well, my being a Christian and all. To this she responded, "Oh, are you afraid that you're going to get struck with a bolt of lightning by that old bearded guy on the ceiling of the Sistine Chapel?" "Well, yes," I said. "Well, of course," she exclaimed, as though I was the idiot who raised the question in the first place. She then, with great indignation, emphasized with much hand-waving, launched into a lecture. "Excuse me. That is the peril in which not only prophets, but artists and their muses live and breathe and have our experience. Is it not? How do you think Mikey felt lying up there on top of that old scaffolding month after month after having been explicitly told by the old guy whose portrait he was painting not to create any graven images?" Well, she had me there and she knew it. So she launched into yet another tangent, which even for her was a reach. Paraphrasing W. Terence Gordon, synthesizing Marshall McLuhan, claiming that it turns out that content is an illusion. And how, as an artist, it was my job to sharpen cliches into new forms that jolt us into awareness. Well, she seemed to know, or pretend to know, everything from A to Z, about everyone from Abraham to Zedekiah, majoring in M for Michelangelo, McLuhan, and yours truly, McCloud. Oh, and speaking of King Zedekiah, she actually claimed to have provided some kind of inspiration and protection for his daughter, Tia Tefai, who had become Queen of Ireland back around, I don't know, 583 BC or something. She then threw in my face how I was always talking about how the devil had co-opted the mysteries and powers which God had gifted women and called them his own, and how he had even convinced the church that it was he who was master of these mysteries, and how his doing so had accomplished making them forbidden to the bride of Christ by the very church itself. She reminded me how I was always saying that the bride must take back her power and establish it firmly at the foot of the cross, as Mary and I say, "The bride has arrived." Well, this was just a bit too fundamentalist to be what I may have actually said, but close enough by her standards. She then called me a coward and told me to put up or shut up. Oh. Then, with streaks of shimmering ribbons in every color of red that light has ever touched, and raggedy old veils of streaming vermilion, she draped herself seductively across the top of my big orange iMac as though it were her chaise lounge, covering my desk and keyboard with ruby spills, scattered sequins, and a shattering of glistening shards, and lots of red feathers. In a sudden shift back to the Stellamac voice that I loved, she proceeded to explain that due to the determination, commitment, perseverance, grueling study, and hard work I had put into becoming a writer, she had been called to serve as the gateway through which I was to be enabled to write things beyond my own capability and imaginings. She explained that not only did this include providing inspiration and the strength to withstand obsession, but that she was there to protect me. But it did make me a little nervous when she giggled and said, "And honey, where we're going, are you ever going to need some protection?" "From what?" I asked, realizing matters were not in my control and had not been for some time. She winked and, stretching out a wing of feathers the color of fire, said, "From the servants of the evil one, who does not want you to write about the Kabbalah of our mothers. You know the wisdom of our mothers in the Old Testament. Eve, Onia, Sarah, Rebecca, Leah, Rachel. Don't look at me like that. You know exactly who I'm talking about." trying to calm myself, I picked up a clove cigarette. Yes, I still smoked back then. Thinking she would probably get on my case about that too, or maybe even leave. Instead, she whipped out a silver Zippo, exuding that subtle lighter fluid perfume, and lit on a cigarette, and then lit one for herself, exhaled a long stream of smoke, and said, "Well, let's go to work." By the way, she claimed to have gotten a lighter from F. Scott Fitzgerald, but wouldn't show me the engraving, so who knows? As I got to know her better in the days and nights that followed, I figured it was more likely that she got it from Zelda. But that first writing session started as though providing her final credentials with her reciting the poem that had magically appeared on my computer screen, shaped kind of like a chalice. The poem that would introduce the first chapter of my book, Rachel's Bag, In Search of the Kabbalah of Our Mothers. This is what she said, and this is the way she said, looks. This is a kalagrama.
Right.
Sue and I had started out to write a book on numbers and sacred geometry, and the book turned into, as we progressed in our woman's movement, it turned into like to break it back. And the extraordinary wisdom with which women in the Bible acted that were just beyond being able to do without some kind of outside influence affecting their interior beings, as Shiloh talks about it being here, but there was some connection. They were, as Muse Red explained, that there was the work that I had put in, why she had been sent, and that if you want the Muse to show up, don't wait for inspiration. Get to work. It's like when your Muse sees the work that you are doing, they take pity on you. Be obsessive. It's like if you want to get hit by lightning, probably follow Ben Franklin's advice that you need to tie a key to a kite and go out and fly in a thunderstorm, lightning storm. Ain't gonna hit you in the house. You need that inspiration to hit, fly the kite with the key on it, and then electric storm. So this was the beginning of Rachel's Bag, and it just, you know, came out of the blue, shaped like that poem.
We do have copies available.
Great, okay. Rachel is an incredible story, what she did. And to me, she's the key. Although she was accused of stealing and risked her life to do it, she brought some things from home that she wasn't supposed to take. And from my studies, what she took was the healing, the medicine bag information. They called it the gods, but when you actually check it in the Hebrew, it's connected to, of all things, stitching and healing. That's the root for the word that they called gods. Rachel never called them gods. And she brought those out with her, and I feel that that's her bag, it's the medicine bag that we're tapping into, came thousands of years ago, and that it's opening to us now.
And that Rachel's tomb is wrapped 7 times with red thread.
Mm-hmm. Isn't that interesting? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I just now learned that. Mm-hmm. I've always been the kind of woman that likes to drink out of a bottle.
Woman after my own heart.
Rachel's bag. We gathered up the knives of the God of our lives and the swords of our wisdom and words. Gathered the prayer stones of our sages. Gathered the cards of our pages. Gathered club, cup, and star. Shuffled and hid them in the rug and furniture. of the camel that took Rachel afar in the direction towards Bethlehem, carrying with her the secret code of the Kabbalah of our mothers. If you hurry, you can still catch her, along with all of the others, at an address in Genesis 31:31, but you will not be allowed to search her, nor make her return, for on her is the custom of women. And the custom of women in the Hebrew is she was in her womb and she was protected from being searched, which if they had found the idols with her, she would have been killed. And because of that taboo about that we think is so bad about isolating women, that we used to think was so bad and then they were outcast, was that taboo that protected our information. That information was brought out under blood. And we have it now. So how am I doing on time? So I don't know how much we have to go into here. Why poetry? Right brain, left brain. Right brain works with your images. Left brain works with the writing. When we move back and forth between working between the writing and the painting and having the one thing inform the other back and forth, it's been our experience that that's what the breakthroughs are about. That's a big, big part of it, is like to get both sides of the brain working at the same time. Back to the poetry. Why poetry? What are the difficulties? It's interesting that with all the courses that we've taught, and I've taught poetry on legend and on color of woman and on Red Madonna, and everyone that I've talked to has said they're more afraid of the poems of writing than they are of the paintings. And so we were talking recently about, you know, why this is the case. And there's a lot of reasons for it. One of it is that poetry has a lot of rules connected to it in the classic form. It's now practically a free-for-all. You can just pretty much say whatever you want. And so many of the things that are being published these days are things that you have to work really hard at writing to make them so that you can't understand them. You know, it's like oblique is really hip and in. I personally prefer the poets of the 1800s. Because I like filling a form. And when you're forced to fill a form, things come up that you're not, that you wouldn't ordinarily, they're not part of the subject. Like here you've got this subject going and you come up with a word. And you want to fill the form of a rhyming poem. Well, here's a word, you look there and go, well, let's see, that's kind of at the end of that statement. And so maybe that's the one I want to make. Oh, actually, here's a little rhyme down here for this already there. But it needs another one for that. Because the poem will let you know what shape it wants to be, because it's got its own life, you know. You can look at it later and not even recognize it, except it's in your handwriting, you know. And so the poem will tell you, like the muse will tell you what it is that you need to do. Just put that pencil to the page or the fingers to the keys and move in trust. So if you need to find a rhyme, you'll be sorting through, like, well, what rhymes with that? And the rhyme will come up and you're like, I don't have anything to say about that. And so what happens? Why did that particular word come up? Well, because it rhymes. But if you hunt that word down inside of you and try to find a sentence to go with it that's consistent with what you've been trying to say here, or what the muse is trying to say, or what is coming forth is trying to say, it's going to take you on a ride. It's going to take you on a journey. We're going to remember things, some of them that we don't even want to remember, but we need to remember them in order to heal. So working with a form is really important. It's like you don't have to choose to write in that form forever, but take on writing in a form and start with a haiku relatively simple, but do follow the rules of the haiku. Like, really know what that is and do it so that you fill the form. The hardest one for me is the sonnet, and it's got all kinds of rules. And but I always tell people, write a sonnet. Look up what it says about that and write that and see what it feels like to fill a form like that. It'll give you a whole new experience of what poetry is about. So that's having to reach and to go deeper. And about the image and the word, Sue and I used to love to have these long discussions about image and word. And she would start out with things like, you know, a single image is worth a thousand words. And I would say to her, honey, you give me 1,000 words and I'll give you images for the rest of your life. And I would say things like, well, you know, creation was spoken into being. I mean, creator could have chosen anything creator wanted to in order for all this being to be. And she said, except humans, of course. So, I'm going to read the poem that is part of your assignment. How are we for time?
What is the time?
It is 1:43.
And we're supposed to be done at
1:45, 1:50.
I was recently rereading The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, which is just such an incredible long poem about going to sea and what happened there. And so much of our sayings, like about his neck an albatross was hung, or water, water everywhere, not a drop to drink, came from this poem. And it was written in the 1700s or early 1800s, and the critics just panned it. They hated it. But for years and years and years, literature and poetry was taught in university from The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. I was recently rereading it, and I was reading a James Russell Lowell's commentary on Coleridge's diction, and it just so spoke to my heart that I want to share it with you. It's just a little paragraph. And he was in favor. He was one that defended Coleridge as being an absolute genius. He said, the words seem common words enough, but in the order of them, in the choice, variety, and position of the vowel sounds, they become magical. The most decrepit vocable in the English language throws away its crutches to dance and sing at his piping. Mm-hmm. Oh. It is so beautiful. So, you've already got your paintings well on the way, and a specific color may be speaking to you. This is going to be it, right? But getting in touch with the color that your muse is, or represents at this particular point. She'll come up with lots more, believe me. And it may already be on your painting, or it may not. So don't be stuck to it. Let her speak to you as to whether or not it's already on your painting or not. But ask her what colors she is, which you've been doing ever since you started, because you're working with color. What happened, my transformation in this particular workshop was during one of the meditations. And I realized that this poem that I had written, I don't know, over 20 years ago, it was when Julia Cameron's The Artist's Way came out. One of the assignments was to write a poem about, I think, a color, and I chose black. Mm-hmm. And in our experience the other day, I got that the reason that this poem was written in first person, it's because she was the first muse. It wasn't Muse Red. It was Muse Black who spoke to me. And I had such an experience. experience of her while we were in that meditation. And so when you write your poem, tense and all of that, see how she wants to show up. Does she want to speak to you in first person? That's a wonderful way to have your write the poem in first person, I as the muse. Or you can write about her, as Shiloh suggested, writing a letter to her. And so this is what showed up for me. And I really didn't want to do that assignment because I thought how trite. Oh, please, Julia. Way beyond that. And this, and the reason I'm reading this one is not only because it's about color, but because it's the most requested poem of people who know of my work. They always like this one, so. Black. I am the color black. I ride on a luminous raven's back. I reside in that complex where colors converge. Why, out of me, the thoughts of genius emerge. Yet, when it comes to simplicity, well, I am the epiphany. I am the ace of spades. I am cool. I am shade. I am rebel and renegade. I hang out in alleys and make you afraid. I am the inside of a grin. I am scale. I am skin. I am the fin of the shark that slices the sea. I am dark, yet children love to play in me. Ollie, 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 oxen, free, free, free. I take naps beneath the willow tree. I am the favorite color of gym. I am deliberate. I am never a whim. I point the way. I delineate. I define and I indicate. I am the shape of words on paper. Rivers on maps, Roman numerals on clocks, eight balls and bullseyes and the feathers of fighting cocks. I am the proper caper. I rate. For patent leather and dress socks, any other color but me would be a total catastrophe. I am paradox. I am predictable to the point of cliche. Yet full of surprises, huh? Just funny that way. I am the siren who sings from the sea, the crack in the mirror, the mystery. I am under the bed in the nursery. Never explained or fully known, I lie with the lizard beneath the stone. I ride with the desperado. I hide in his gun. I am lace for the lady. I am robe for the nun. For the poet? Well, for the poet I am the chosen one. There is no place I have not been. Why, in heaven they call me the devil's friend. Look at the sky. You will find that I am the space that stars happen in, and also the place where witches fly. Yet cozy as the breast of an angel am I, for I am the blanket of night. I am the air beneath the wings of all things that at sunset take flight, like, for instance, the moth and the bat. Remember, I am black. I absorb light. Without me, where would she be? Or for that matter, white. Ever think of that or of this? I am the lock where lips come together and kiss. I am the knock at the door of bliss. I am the footstep that tips down the hall. The mom on the other side of the wall. I am the secret you must never tell. Not to mention the fact that I am. And I am the inner workings of the mind, the center around which the whirlpool whirls. I am peace to the dead. I am perfect with pearls. I go great with red. I am right for every occasion. Elegance personified is what I am. One need take no chance, for I am appropriate, perennial. I'm in. I am worn with gardenias by beautiful women. I am the tie and tails worn by gentlemen. Well, there's more, of course. But most important of all, I am the tuxedo Satan wore when he invited Eve to the fall. So I'm just going to close with my favorite poem. And thank you all so very much for being such a great and responsive audience. I just love looking at your faces. Yeah, they get it, they get it. I've always been intrigued with the fact that, I've always known this, spoken art for a few years, that the language, that hand and language occur in the same place in the brain, so that they're very dependent on it, they're very much the same, and that handwriting and why we talk with our hands the way we do, the fact that the image was first, like the hand, like the whole Hebrew alphabet is created by a little hood, which is the number 10, which is represents a hand. The whole alphabet was created by the hand of God. That's the Kabbalah teaching on that. I love that stuff. And the fact that language, we think of like we are who we are, little children, and then we find the language to define it and describe it. And the thing is that it's the language that informs who we are. My shiro, Helen Keller, said that it was just a black hole until she could say water. Mm-hmm. You know, until she could bring language to the experience, it had no meaning for her. She wrote poetry, deaf, dumb, and blind. She wrote poetry after her guardian held her hand out of that water, told her how to speak it. And so I think about the beginning of language and how that might have been for those, my relationship with scriptures, to go there and feel like, what was Eve thinking? And when I see her, I'm going to say, girlfriend, what were you thinking? Oh, God, I know, it was just, I don't, it's okay, honey, if it hadn't been you, it would have been me. I love her, our mother. So, this is like taking a simple thing, like Jonathan's wires on the bus line wires, a gull. This is about a gull, which ended up being a whole book about gull, but this was the beginning of it. It's called Eve Speaks to Her Gull. It's this one. Gull, while I was yet Adam's rib, God called your name out of me, closing the back of the throat and shaping it there like your first egg, carving a hollow in the roof of the mouth, swelling it against root of tongue, tongue curling back on itself and then touching its tip to the back of the teeth like the index finger finding her thumb for the first time. And then hooking that final webbed claw between shoulder blades and demanding, speak or die. All this gone while you waited to be spoken alive. God, yours was a violent birth, choked into creation, splitting the universe and engraving the air with the ciphers and glyphs of flight and the remembrance of wings. And God shouted, let there be freedom. And God saw that it was good. And God commanded me to wait, even as you, Gull, had waited. He commanded me to rest there, next to my husband's heart, in that helix of DNA, in that curve that giving birth to your name had caused, in that curve that would be translated rib, in that rib that would be translated form, in that form that would be translated woman. In that woman, that would be translated Eve, mother of all living. In that mother of all living, that would be translated bitter. In that bitter, it would be translated Mary. All this, Gull, so that God could enter Earth and all her poetry hang on a dead tree and with human ears hear your cry.
How I got the way that I am.
Yeah.
You think I'm intense.